gives me very, very great pleasure to welcome a really special guest who is somebody that really has made an amazing effort, spent an enormous amount of energy to become familiar with and really engaged with Asia and Asia Pacific. I'd like to introduce Steve Jensen. Steve, welcome to Music Matters and All That Matters. Give Steve a big round of applause.
Thank you.
So Steve is one of the founders of the Direct Management Group based in Los Angeles. And just to give you all a little bit of a flavor of direct management, way, way back in 1985, Steve, together with his founding partner, Martin Kirkup, decided that they would like to establish a management company that really worked with a difference, something that worked and engaged with talent and artists, developed their music, developed their creative aesthetic in a really interesting way. And they've done this remarkably well. They started off managing bands like Orchestral Maneuvers in the Dark,
yep.
Echo and the Bunnymen, even Brian Ferry, the well-known British singer, and then had a lot of success with the B-52s. And with a quadruple platinum album called Cosmic Thing, right?
Yep.
So
1989,
so that's going back quite a ways. And then in 1991, they signed a band from San Francisco called Counting Crows. How many of you have heard of Counting Crows? Indeed. Oh, good, we've got some people there who know about Adam Duritz. And then in the 90s, working with people like David Byrne of the Talking Heads, Tracy Chapman, and a band called the New Radicals. So that really was kind of teeing up for where you are now. Oh, there we are. So we'll start off by just showing you the team at Direct. There you can see Steve on the left with his partners, Bradford Cobb, who they work very, very closely with. A young woman in the middle of the group there that we'll tell you about in a little while. Martin Kirkup. Martin is this very genial, very smart, strategic thinker, and it's a wonderful combination of the three. And then also we have
Nock Wong, who is an associate manager with us and works on a day-to-day basis with Katy Perry.
So you pronounce your name Nock?
Nock Wong.
Nock Wong. And so Nock, clearly part of the team, and there are a number of other associate managers within the Direct management team in LA looking at and looking after the talent. But this whole notion of developing the aesthetic of the artists, I thought we'd start off by one of the very, very exciting artists that you're working with now. Here's a young man who started out life in musical theater.
Correct.
He hears about an audition for American Idol.
He was on stage at the Pantages Theater in
Hollywood.
LA. In Hollywood,
right.
Yeah. In Wicked. He was in the chorus.
Wicked.
In the Wicked.
Right, the musical.
The musical, and I think it was the eighth season of American Idol, and they were in Los Angeles for rehearsal or for auditions.
Right.
And someone said you should go audition. He dropped everything one afternoon, went and auditioned, and that's where it all started.
So he basically wins American Idol.
No, he did not win. Actually, he was runner up.
So he was runner up, but when he was in those finals. He would be appearing before 20, 30 million people.
Yeah, 30. I think 33, 35 was the maximum, the top.
And a fantastic voice, Adam Lambert is his name.
Incredible, incredible voice.
So he's the runner-up.
Yes.
And how did you get to meet him and to decide you were going to manage him and see a long-term future for him?
Well, at the time, American Idol contestants had to sign a contract or an agreement whereby they would be managed by a group of people that were tied to the production company for the program. If they went on to have a recording career, they would be signed to RCA Records. And he had to do that like everyone else. And that ran its course. He had one album out with a hit called What Do You Want From Me? And it was quite successful. He got a lot of attention from there was a lot of speculation that he would be the winner that year, and there was somewhat of a surprise when he didn't win. A young man called Chris Allen won that year, but Adam anyway went on to have a fairly thriving career, and with that hit single, and then that sort of ran its course. I think that Simon Fuller then sold 19, the production.
So Simon Fuller was the guy who created the concept of American and Pop Idol.
He created it with Simon Cowell, correct.
Right.
And he sold to a company out of New York, and that gave Adam an out to go seek other management.
Which is how
And then that's how I got involved, we got involved, yes.
So what was it about his voice that made you and Martin and think
well,
of...
Well, to be candid, we're not super keen on these talent contests because it's really not about the music, it's about television, right? It's about the show.
Right.
And, you know, television is an incredible revenue earner, and American Idol was incredibly successful, as is The Voice currently in the States. But the artists, you know, there are very few artists that go on to have a thriving career. But this kid, and I call him a kid because, you know, he's still a kid, he's 33 years old, he's a great, great guy. He had, you know, such incredible talent that it was undeniable. And when he became available, we thought we would take the opportunity to have a chat with him, and he chose us as his managers.
And then you did something really interesting because you saw this longer range ability, but also recognized, as you've done for many years in your own career, of looking at international and the international markets to develop someone's career and their career impact. And you arranged for him to join and play with Queen.
Yes and no. He actually, on the finale of American Idol, which I believe was 2008 or 2010, I can't remember. Anyway, Queen, which was Brian May and Roger Taylor, performed on the show with Adam and Chris Allen, the kid who eventually won. And that sort of started somewhat of a relationship. You know, it was obvious that Adam, with his voice, was a natural for that fit with them. But when we got involved with him, first of all, we view management of artists from a global perspective all the time. From the very beginning to the end, this is a small world, and you know, if an artist doesn't have global potential, then we're not really interested. First of all, they have to be incredibly talented, and we have to...
Ambitious?
Well, yes, but have music, you know, their songwriting that we like. We have to like it. If you're not going to like... You know, this is not a job, it's a lifestyle.
Right.
Right?
It's a love
style. So if you love it and hate it at the same time.
Exactly.
Because it's a 24/7 job, 24/7 lifestyle. But anyway, he had that experience with Queen on American Idol, and then when we got involved with him, I had heard that Queen were going to be honored with an award at the MTV European Music Awards in Belfast. It was probably 2011 or so, and that they had chosen Lady Gaga as their singer. But then that fell apart for whatever reason, I don't know. And Adam, so I made a phone call to Jim Beach, who is Queen's manager. He's their long time manager. And said, you know, Queen's going to be honored in Belfast at the EMAs. You know, we manage Adam. Think it would be a great fit. Let's give it a try. And they were up for it, and they did. And that's what started that. So Adam has a multifaceted career. He has, you know, some of you might know or probably do know that Adam has toured with Queen as the lead singer for the past year and
traveling all over the world, many different countries.
We've toured everywhere in the world except for South America, which we're doing in September. But at the same time, so that's, you know, very important, and it has given him incredible profile, and he's an amazing singer, an amazing personality, and people got to know him outside of America in a much bigger way. And at the same time, while he was on the road during the tour, during off times, he was recording a solo record. Well, we got him off of RCA Records, and we signed him to
Warner.
So
he was with RCA for a record that did pretty well.
Pretty well, and the second record did not do well.
Okay, and so after that, you decided time for a change. You go to Warner Brothers Records.
Correct.
Working with Cameron Strang, who's Correct. Their new president. Very Correct. Creative guy, also runs Warner Chappell Music.
Yes, Cameron is key, but also Max Martin, the producer, the Swedish producer, singer-songwriter, producer.
So isn't Max Martin is the guy who
Not
wrote...
Not singer-songwriter, songwriter.
Songwriter, so, yes. who wrote a lot of the hits for Backstreet Boys, Britney Spears.
Yeah, he's done, and he actually was involved with What Do You Want From Me, the first... Adam Lambert single off the first album.
Uh-huh.
And also a collaborator with Katy Perry. So we have a long-term relationship.
Oh, I see. So he collaborated with Katy even before the Adam relationship.
From the first album.
Because there was a writing partnership between the two, Katy and Adam.
Co-writing and producing.
Incredible. Yep. So you go to a new record label, a new start.
Mm-hmm.
Here he's on the set of Glee, the very successful...
Yeah, he has a multifaceted career, like I said, and part of it is that... You know, there's a lot of interest in him for television, and there's a lot of interest in him for musical theater. We've had several offers for Broadway plays and musicals, but it's now time to focus on a solo career. We have a new album coming out in June, a new single out in about 3 weeks ago.
So Adam Lambert teams up with Max Martin, goes to Scandinavia, writes,
Max and his
records.
Team. Max has a...
Brings out a whole new facet of his creative expression, I guess you can call it. And the net result of the new recording coming out and the single coming out, what's your verdict?
What's my verdict? I love the album, but you know, I'm biased, of course, but I really do genuinely love the album.
Right.
And Adam is... You know, not only talented, but a very hard worker. He's determined, he's ambitious, he's focused. Right. And, you know, we're off to a great start at radio in America, radio in Canada, radio in Australia, but it's very early days.
Now, Queen wouldn't hire someone to be the singer, basically doing the Freddie Mercury songs, unless the guy was really good.
Yeah, they wouldn't. And you know, we took a chance. We all took a chance. You know, Roger and Brian and Jim Beach and I and Adam and Martin and Bradford, we took a leap of faith. We felt that it was something we were confident. We sold the North American tour to Live Nation, who took a chance, and it just proved to be successful.
Fantastic. Yep. So Adam Lambert, big priority for direct management.
Absolutely.
Interesting. Opportunity. Now, here's an interesting shot.
Yeah, I manage Barack Obama, if you didn't know as well.
Oh, yes, you've just signed Barack Obama. That's
yeah,
right.
Yeah. He's a great singer.
I hear he's quite a good
singer. And his backup singer right there. Yeah, what's her name?
So the reason that we brought up this particular slide here is that there's an artist you've been associated with for a long time, somebody who you intrinsically believed in when she was really... playing in very, very small clubs, not really getting the exposure you felt merited her great creative talent, incredible voice, purity of vocal timbre. And this is K.D. Lang.
Yeah, so she had actually had a thriving career before she came to us. She had a huge album in North America and the UK and Australia called Ingenue that had a hit single, her, as she says, her only hit single. When she performs it, she says she calls out that she's going to play her medley of her one hit,
right?
Called "Constant Craving" and
"Constant Craving."
Constant
that's
Craving.
Right. It was a huge
I always I was a big fan. I remember a great record man called Carl Scott at Warner's turning me on to her back in probably late eighties. Seymour Stein signed her to Sire Records.
Seymour, who was here last year.
Yeah, he's great. He went to see her. I remember him calling me the day that he was on his way up to Edmonton to see her.
So what did he say to you?
He said, I'm going to go see this great singer. You know, she's a cowpunk.
Cowpunk
singer. Yeah. You know, you should check her out. So he went up to see her in this little club. And KD now tells me that he came to see me and he fell asleep while
he was watching her.
But anyway, he signed her. And but Carl Scott turned me on to her music. And... You know, as managers, I don't believe in poaching other managers' artists. I think it's wrong. We have an unwritten understanding, or unspoken understanding that we don't do that. It's unethical.
Yeah.
She became available in 2000. Yeah, I got a call. I was with Counting Crows in Paris, actually. I got a call asking me if I would meet with her. And I tried to meet with her for a long time, and she wouldn't meet with me. So anyway, she came in, we met with her, and eventually she told me the reason she wouldn't meet with me is because everybody told her she should meet with me.
She wouldn't meet with you because everyone said she should meet with you.
Yeah, because artists don't want to be told what to do, and they shouldn't be told what to do, right?
Right.
You know, their mania, their rebellion, and that's what, you know, creates their art. They should never be told what to do. They can, you know, be advised what to do, and that's, you know, part of my job. But anyway, she came to us, and, you know, the big problem with KD, or the big issue with her at the time, was that she was known as this lesbian who happened to be a great singer. And I told her, and Martin and Bradford told her that you know, if you're going to come to us, we're going to change that. We're going to do everything we can to change it so that you become known as the great singer who happens to be a lesbian. And I think we achieved that. It took a long time. It's like steering a huge ship in the middle of the night. But it turned out to be successful, and she's an amazing artist. She's a very dear friend of my husband, Mark, and I, and she's wacky as can be, and she is stubborn as shit, but she's incredible. And you know, when you hear that voice...
Of that voice, yeah. The tone in the voice.
Yeah.
It's really extraordinary, isn't it?
Yeah, it is, and we took her on to... one of the first things we did was we coupled her with Tony Bennett.
The jazz great.
Yep, the jazz great, and we did a great tour, and that turned into an album, which was of standards, which was very successful.
4 million worldwide.
Yeah, and incredibly successful. And then she decided she wanted to do an album of Canadian standards.
Canadian standards by Canadian.
By Canadian artists, correct? By songwriters, and it called "Hymns of the 49th Parallel," and that was incredibly successful. And we. Toured on that for a year with symphonies around the world. That was, anyway, so here we are today. You know, she's had a great career. You know, she was the focal point of the opening ceremony of the 2010 Vancouver Winter
this
Olympics.
This is a picture here. That's of her. Her, yeah, the opening ceremony,
yeah, that was
in Vancouver.
One of her shining moments, and she loved it, and we all loved it.
And of course, that got you immense global coverage because of the Olympics.
Yeah.
If you're at the Olympics, it's kind of like, it's bigger than the Super Bowl, really. It's a global
audience. It's huge. She has three billion, I think, people. So she still has a thriving career. She's not the most ambitious person, but she likes to have a very quiet life. And my dear friend Paul Dainty, who's might be out there somewhere,
Paul is
knows that very well.
The world's great concert promoters.
The world's great concert promoters.
Here in the audience?
I met Paul. I got to be very close friends with Paul because of Katy, because he is her promoter, and we continue to talk about how we, you know, have to light a fire under this young woman to get her to work. But
and of course, she's a very big artist in Australia.
Very big in Australia.
And has played in Hong Kong and played in Singapore.
Correct.
So
yeah.
She's pretty good.
Yeah.
Very interesting. Okay, so. Having said that,
then there's her.
Then we've got this young woman who you've been managing now since 2004.
Correct, when she was 19 years old. And Bradford, who is our business
one of your partners.
Yeah, Bradford came to us about 17 or 18 years ago as an assistant, and he was at a party in Hollywood. And met this young lady and came to the office the next day, and he said, I think I've met somebody who's really special. 19 years old, had been a Christian singer, an artist she dropped out of high school in Santa Barbara, California.
At the age of 15?
At 15.
15.
And
so she never finished high school?
She never finished high school, but she is incredibly bright and clever.
So at 15, she comes down to LA.
No, at 15, she went to Nashville. Her mother and father are traveling Pentecostal ministers. So they're
church ministers.
Charismatic ministers, preachers. And her mother supported her, took her to Nashville and lived with her. And she wrote and recorded a Christian album, which didn't do well. And then she, at 16, moved to Hollywood. And
so that takes a lot of balls for parents to say, 15, I'll help you do what your passion really is. Your passion is to sing, to perform, to express your creative aesthetic.
Yeah, but they're very supportive parents because they're kind of performers in their own right.
Right.
Her father is very charismatic, and she gets a lot of her charisma and her entertainment abilities and talent from her father.
And there's a record producer who had a lot of success as a producer with many hits by the name of Glenn Ballard.
Correct.
Who was also part of that early...
Yeah, she when she first came to Hollywood, she went to his place and knocked on his door and said, you know, because she was a big fan of Alanis Morissette, who was...
Oh, that's what Glenn co-produced, the big Alanis Morissette.
Jagged Little Pill. Uh-huh. And she was not a cover girl back in 2004, I can assure you of that. But anyway, Glenn took her under his wing and signed her to a deal, and then...
So she was first signed to Def Jam.
Def Jam through Glenn.
And then that didn't work
apart,
out.
Right, and then Glenn signed her to Sony Columbia.
Sony Columbia.
Correct. And they didn't really get Katy. You know, they tried to, like I said before, never tell an artist what he or she should do creatively, ever. You know, we
ever.
Ever.
I like that.
Because you know, a successful artist, an artist is successful if he or she is authentic to
their craft.
Themselves.
Right.
And to the craft, yeah. And if they're not, it becomes obvious. And we, as human beings, we have an innate ability to detect inauthenticity immediately. I believe that.
And that's even more so in a social media world like today, you can see when something is basically not real.
Yeah, and I think, you know, I firmly believe that Katy Perry has the biggest Twitter following in the world because she's authentic. You know, she's beautiful, she's engaging, she's smart, she's funny, she's talented, she writes good songs, she's a great entertainer, but she is real. And that is probably the most important thing. All of our artists are real, you know.
And was it just that kind of authenticity that when you met with her and saw this drive and this authenticity, was that one?
Bradford, you know, caught that first, at that very first party he met her at. And, you know, Bradford comes from Cotton Farm, very big, you know, very big family cotton farmers in Mississippi. And he's a genuine lover of music but also just a great human being and is personable and emotional and, you know, wears his heart on his sleeve and you know, he just sensed from her immediately that she was real. So
then she signs with Capitol Records.
Yeah, we were able to get her out of the Sony Columbia deal, and then we signed her to Virgin, the Virgin label, Jason Flom, who was heading up that label at the time, out of New York. And so that's what started it all. Or that's what started this most
recent.
And
then she's had a number of hits. What were the first three major hits in
this
year? Because if you look at this slide we've got up on the screen, there she's getting an award for 72 million digital single sales.
Yeah.
What were the first three hits?
Well, the first song that came out, we put out digitally through with a video, and it's called You're So Gay. And that caught a lot of attention. Madonna at the time, you know, talked about it on radio with Ryan Seacrest, I think, or something like that. And so that got a lot of attention. That was in November of 2007. And then in May of 2008, we put out I Kissed a Girl, which was a bit risky because I Kissed a Girl is, you know, wondered if there was concern about whether radio would play it or not, but it was an obvious hit.
Such a great chorus.
Yeah, but then, you know, then there was the talk that she was a one-hit wonder. But we firmly believed in her and genuinely believed in her and
but stuck with it. It was a huge hit all over the world.
It was a huge hit all over the world. And the next song was Hot and Cold.
Yeah.
And, you know, Waking Up in Vegas, just went on from there, from the first album.
Incredible.
Yeah.
And she writing all of the songs or being
co-writing,
a principal writer, co-writer.
Correct.
So this is somebody whose talent has got real depth.
Yes. Yeah. And we knew that. And she's just an amazing young woman. You know, she's, Emma Banks, who's here, is Katy's agent.
Emma Banks is her longtime agent.
Yep, and the best agent in the world.
Best agent in the world.
Anybody says? Anybody else says?
Emma, that's good to hear from a manager like yourself.
She's incredible. You know why she's the best?
Why?
No, not the why she's the best. She just happens to be the best. The reason she is really good is because she doesn't take no for answer, she doesn't take yes for an answer, and she challenges me. And I just do not like working with agents who are sort of, you know,
wimpy
and, you know, just take instruction. And she also has a very, very good sense of the global marketplace and each market within the global marketplace, which and the strategies necessary to help develop an artist's live career in those parts of the in all parts of the world.
Okay, so an interesting thing is, as you've developed her, here's a picture of her stagecraft and just the incredible productions you've assembled. Mm-hmm. Let's have a look. Here's another just incredible costume that she uses. Her own thinking, her own design.
Yeah, this is an outfit that was designed by Jeremy Scott, who is the lead designer, creative director at Moschino. American, but is a creative director at Moschino in Milan. And they're very good friends, and so Katy and Jeremy collaborated on this outfit. This was the opening outfit for the Prismatic World Tour, which we are currently on. And this is the firework outfit designed by a New York guy called Todd Thomas.
Incredible costuming. Mm-hmm. Here's she's like the movie Up. She wanted to take over across the audience. I mean, this is really...
Yeah, this is a performance of Birthday on the Prismatic World Tour. And she flies around the stadium or the arena.
She flies around the stadium?
Well, yeah, and, you know, of course, she has hot air balloons.
With balloons?
Yeah, you would fly too if you were holding...
Well, of course.
Yeah.
Precisely.
Yeah.
So one of the things that's interesting is this year you did the Super Bowl, the American Football Super Bowl, which is a massive, massive event. 125 million people watch it just in America.
Correct.
Worldwide, about 500 million.
Correct.
It took you 3 years to put this together.
In a sense, yes. I mean, it was a campaign that we started 3 years before it actually happened, and NFL is... As some of you might know, not necessarily the non-Americans, but NFL is the National Football League. It's controlled by 32 billionaire owners, 32 teams, and they're incredibly conservative, and all they care about is their bottom line. And they've had mishaps with Janet Jackson with the wardrobe malfunction, and they had the mishap with MIA when she flipped a. Gave the bird to the camera when she
it
was
took you 3 years
Madonna.
To convince them that Katy was going to do the job.
Yeah, they're very conservative, very careful, and very cautious. And it just took it was a long process.
And you had to perform in the halftime, which is 15 minutes?
12 minutes.
And so you've got to be choreographed to the split second for the 12 minutes go on, off, do this incredible show.
Yes.
You're seen by the world.
Yes.
Amazing. Okay, so let's just move on to more interesting. One of the things that's been amazing about what you've done is you've put great emphasis on making the most amazing videos. And I want to show one video
here.
Okay,
before you do that, though, I think that's important to point out that, you know, it's not just me. It's a team of people. And like Katy always says, it takes a village. You know, it starts with her. She's an incredible leader. And I've always believed that it all starts at the top. And you know, great leadership and great things come from from the top. We collaborate well. We talk a lot and we discuss things and ideas. And I give her suggestions, and Martin gives her suggestions, and Bradford gives her suggestions, and Nock gives her suggestions. At the end of the day, it's always her decision. And she has an amazing way of she knows what resonates.
Let's show this video, because this video has so far amassed 979 million views on Vevo. And if you combine that with YouTube, this is like a billion view video.
Katy Perry, Juicy J. Let's rage.
And here you were, you were gonna come to me.
And here you are,
but you better choose carefully.
Cause
I'm capable of anything.
You should know what you're falling for. Baby, do you dare to do this? Cause I'm coming at you like a dark horse.
Incredible. So, I mean, that costs a lot of money.
Yes.
But the whole thing, the way it was put together, the production of it, what you do in an amazing way is, I'm going to go to the next video now, which is taking that same song that you now take to a live audience, in fact, in Indonesia just 10, 12 days ago, and you take the same song, you bring this incredible production.
So what happens there is Katy and management, Bradford, Martin, myself, will sit with Baz Halpin, who's her creative director, her production designer. He works with Taylor Swift, he works with Pink, Cher, Tina Turner, Usher, lots of people. He's a great guy, Irish bloke. And he and basically it's Katy and Baz collaborating, talking about a storyline for the show, for the entire show, and come up with ideas, and then we hire people to design the various props.
So the horse flew with you from LA to Jakarta?
It's been all around the world.
That horse.
Yeah. It's a flying horse.
Incredible. Okay, so here's another quick clip we want to show of another video. This is called Raw, and just giving another sense about the incredible visual versatility that your kind of combined thinking is able to deploy.
Yeah, Martin is the genius behind the video making for our company.
Ready?
Held me down, but I got up. Already brushing off the dust. Hear my voice, hear that sound. Like thunder gonna shake the ground. Held me down, but I got up. Get ready, cause I've had enough.
So another great conceptual idea, hit single, Roar,
yeah,
video, 940 million views so far.
Something like that,
it's about a billion views. I mean, that's amazing.
Yeah, but I didn't do all that myself.
No, but I mean, it's your team that puts all this together.
We work hard, we have fun.
I mean, that's the great thing about it. It's fun.
I'm a really lucky guy. Really lucky guy.
Amazing. Okay, so let's move on and just take a look here. This is a series of awards that she's won. Tell us about this one.
This is the MTV Video Music Awards in I think this one was Los Angeles. Yeah, she wore a record outfit. You know, she likes to dress up.
She sure does. With the nice hat there. Let's go to the next one. This is the same thing.
Yeah,
look
same
at that
thing, yeah.
Beautiful. Oh, she's got some records
that
on her dress.
Yeah. Course.
And those are the awards, the Spacemen
yep.
MTV Awards, and obviously she's got her hair colored for the occasion.
That's her natural color.
That's her natural color, of course.
Her other natural color is blue.
Natural color is blue.
Sometimes green.
Okay, let's go to the next picture. Tell us about this.
Sometimes
she was the
black.
Billboard Woman of the Year.
She was in 2013, I think.
Yeah.
Beautiful. 2012,
Woman of the Year?
Woman of the Year.
That's a big deal.
Yeah. I wonder how you become Woman of the Year. But anyway.
Big deal.
Yeah. How do you become Man of the Year?
You've got to wear really smart gear.
You have to be really talented, right?
Exactly.
And have really good management.
Good management.
That's the key.
Good management.
And a great agent, right, Emma?
You've got a good manager in Mill Valley now. Okay, so let's go to the next picture. Here's another award that she gets. Which one is this?
This is Lucille Ball.
No.
This is an American Music Award.
American Music Award. And she's always got this idea of looking distinctive, so you just know that she's got this artistry.
Yeah, it's all her. She creates all that.
Let's take a look at the next one. Here's another big award. It's a Billboard Music Award.
That's right. Billboard Music Award.
Look at that look. She's
in Las Vegas.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
So elegant. So svelte.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Let's go to the next one. Oh, here's something from Nickelodeon, the kids.
Oh, yes. She got a couple of those. You know, I think that's the time when she got splurted with all the gunk, you know, the green.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Here's another one. Who's that?
Another MTV Video Music Award, and I'm not sure who that is.
That's not Usher, is it?
No.
Oh, but still, she's good. That's an MTV award she's getting there. She looks just fabulous. Let's go to another one.
Which award?
The Spirit Award, no?
No, it's not the Spirit Award, I don't think. I can't. There's so many awards.
So many awards. This is just a...
It's ridiculous.
It is.
No, it's not ridiculous that she wins so many. It's just ridiculous there's so many awards. There's award shows just to have an award show.
Right. But here's a really important one. She wins a Brit Award in London.
Yeah, that was...
Very important on a global basis.
Yeah.
Here she is. I mean, look how great she looks.
Yeah.
She looks fabulous.
Yeah, Emma did her makeup that night, I think.
Emma did her makeup?
Yeah.
I can see Emma likes that kind of eyeliner.
And then Emma made sure she...
Emma Banks, the agent and eyeliner specialist.
Yeah.
Very, very good. Yeah. Okay, so let's take a look at what you've been doing in Asia.
Emma did her makeup for this one as well.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
She did. So you first came to Asia in 2009, playing a shopping center in Manila.
Correct.
2009, you were just there last week. You just did a tour that grossed about $20 million for yourselves. That was, you come back in 2012. Is this part of your plan to come back on a regular basis to Asia?
Yeah, it's very important to come back to Asia and every market regularly. On the first three albums, One of the Boys, Teenage Dream, and Prism, we went around the world promoting three times. I think, you know, Paul Dainty can confirm this, but I think we were in Australia three times and ended up doing, you know, having a
three times to promote the album.
Promote the album, and then ended up doing 25 sold out arenas around Australia, which was a great success.
25.
This was the first time Katy came to Manila. She played it was a promo trip, and she played performed at the mall. And then the second time was in 2012, and she performed at the Mall of Asia to about 15,000-20,000 people. Emma will know for sure.
And then she comes back again just a couple of weeks ago. How many people?
We did 30,386.
30,386.
Mm-hmm. And Adam Wilkes.
Just look at that. Three times, 2009, 2012, 2015. Careful, patient building. You working with Emma to build it all up.
Yeah, and then also with AEG and Adam Wilkes, who's our promoter for Asia and did an incredible job on this tour, making sure they give the plugs to the right people.
Adam Wilkes?
Yeah, Adam.
Where's Adam? Adam's here, I believe. Where's Adam? Adam,
he's probably
looking
at
Adam.
Emails or texts right now.
Adam is a...
Turn your phone off.
Master of ceremonies, okay.
Yeah,
and
he's the greatest. And anyway, yes, it's important to come to Asia. It's also important to know when to come. It's also very important to know when not to come, right? So you don't want to overdo it. You know, when we come back on the next tour, we probably won't play all the same markets because we need to give a breather. And I think in Asia, and Australia is somewhat similar, you need to give more space between tours, more space between albums, especially between tours, right? So we won't tour every market in Asia on every tour.
So the power of social media is interesting because you've got 72 million Facebook followers. Mm-hmm. You are the biggest act on Twitter, 70 million plus, bigger than Taylor Swift, bigger than Barack Obama, as a matter of fact.
Yes.
I mean, bigger than the President of the United States, that says something. So here you are, here's a clip that we want to show in Jakarta. So what's important about this is to listen to the way that she works and combines with the members of the audience, a Bahasa-speaking audience,
yes,
but Katy has got this ability to connect. Eddie, let's roll the video. This is Katy in Jakarta 2 weeks ago. Thank you very much. Jakarta.
Jakarta.
Fantastic.
Or as you say, Jakarta.
Jakarta. Incredible. Ladies and gentlemen, see that. Give him a round of applause. That's...
It's not me. Well, I didn't do that.
No, but you... This is all part of your what you do. But,
you know, I think also that brings up a point that I'd like to make that, you know, I believe managers... This is very unusual for me to get up in front of people and talk because I firmly believe that managers should always be behind the camera, behind the stage. Behind the scenes, because it's not about us. It's about Katy or KD or Adam or any of our the other artists. So, you know, we help. We work hard. We try to, you know, make things help.
You help that guy there. I mean, well, he had
a good time, and you know, we're happy for him.
I think he looks like his life has just changed its course in that moment.
Katy's great with her audience. She knows why she's here.
Amazing. So... let's have a look. What have we got next? Here's a very important thing because you believe in giving back.
Yeah.
And she's become a UNICEF ambassador.
Global Goodwill Ambassador.
And this is taken in Madagascar, the
fourth poorest country in the world. We went there 2 years ago. It was an incredible trip. We went deep into the bush and checked out initiatives, UNICEF initiatives for these children. And Katy... One of the, you know, she's, like I said, she's a great girl. She knows that her celebrity is not just about buying houses and going on glamorous vacations, but also about giving back.
So on this trip to Asia, you also went to Ho Chi Minh City, doing something similar for UNICEF?
Correct. We were in Ho Chi Minh City last week with UNICEF.
That's in Madagascar?
That's Madagascar. Wonderful people.
So she's got this commitment to give back and...
Yes. And raise money.
Give out.
We raised about $750,000 for the U.S. fund for UNICEF on the North American tour.
Amazing.
She's, you know, she cares.
So
but she should care.
She should care.
She's gotten a lot. You know, she's had hard times. When I first managed her, you know, for the first few years, her car was being repossessed. She was kicked out of apartments, and now she's, you know, doing quite well. And it gives her opportunity to use her fame and her fortune and her celebrity to give back.
She's a human doing,
really
not a human being.
She's a human doing.
She's a
I'll
human
tell
doing.
That. Yeah.
So, what has she got coming up over the next few months? Because
you
finished this tour, the tour's broken up, all of the equipment gone back to LA. So, tell us what happens in September, October.
It's on a slow boat back to the US, and then September she'll headline Rock in Rio.
That's the huge, a million people almost.
Yeah, we'll have 100,000 for the actual show, but yeah, it's over the course of a couple weekends, and then Emma's booked a great tour for South America, Lima, 8 shows, Lima, Bogota, San Juan, Puerto Rico, Curitiba, Santiago, Buenos Aires, Sao Paulo, and Rio.
And in the meantime, she's writing because you've got new...
She'll start writing in this fall, but she'll probably get bored over the summer and start writing because she can't sit still. And then we'll have an album out hopefully in late 2016.
Late 2016. So you'd plan in 2-3 year cycles?
Yeah, we have a sense of what's going on in her schedule.
So Steve, when we look at Adam Lambert, Katy Lang, Katy Perry, the way that direct management works and interfaces. I know that you like to stay in the background rather than the foreground, but just looking at all of the functional, logistical organization that needs to keep these things together on a professional basis, that's a skill.
Yeah, but it's what I do.
It's what you do, and you love it.
And I love it.
And your time in Asia, it's been a positive,
fantastic,
progressive thing for you?
Yeah, with, you know, Adam Wilkes has done... Made us feel very welcome, you know, and
age,
I have a great
fantastic
relationship with Jay Marciano, who's been a friend of mine for 35 plus years, and he, you know...
Jay is the COO of
Like I said,
age,
you know,
Eli.
Leadership starts at the top, and how everything else happens down below starts at the top, and Jay great leader and has a great team. John Capo did an amazing job of helping us get sponsors.
And John's sitting right there. I can see him getting embarrassed. You can't see him in the dark light. But Steve, this is just something we just focus back again on your team. There's you, Brad, Bradford, Martin. That's the core of direct management, plus Knock.
Knock is key, yes.
Key, absolutely. Yeah. So, ladies and gentlemen, as you can see, Steve is definitely not just a global music industry leader, but a consummate artist manager. Hmm. Please give Steve a really deserved round of applause for really bringing incredible professional skill to Asia.
Thank you. Steve. Thanks for having me. Nice to be here.
Jasper, what a great coup for you to bring Steve in here.
Steve, Ralph, thank you, Steve. Thank you so much for coming all the way from LA.
Happy to be here.
Just wait for 1 second. Is that picture up on the board yet? I can't see. We're 10 years old. Ralph hasn't been to 10, he's been to 9.
Wow.
But I wanted to say a special thanks to Ralph Simon because he's everyone's mentor. I keep saying his is the phone that you want to steal. But thank you, Ralph, for the last 9 years.
Whoa.
I thought you'd appreciate that photograph. That was in Hong Kong in 2010, I think.
Oh, yeah, those are my girls.
But thanks again to
All
Ralph and Steve. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.